How often do you drink Pepsi?
We ought to be recording this.
Right.
I'm recording.
Oh, you are?
What?
No, the way the commercials are, you never mention Pepsi.
Oh, you are.
Right. It's just a new generation, right?
Yeah, never mention it.
And show the candle up.
Yeah.
That's it.
Okay. Geraldine Ferraro.
Yeah.
Are we ready to begin? Let's begin. All right, it's April 4th, 1985. We were talking with James Surls. James is here in connection with the OKUSA National Sculpture Exhibition. And he was the juror for the show. So we're glad to have you here.
My pleasure.
Going to ask a few questions. While he's here, he's also creating a new piece. Have you got a title for the piece you're creating here?
Yeah. It's called 369. Let me tell you why.
You good?
Well, I had three daughters, and then I had three more. So the three went to six. And it took 9 months to make them, you know, and that's a weird kind of sentimental thing that has something to do with me that really doesn't have anything to do with anybody else, but everybody else at one time or another has the same kind of response to a similar situation. In other words, my sentimentality in relation to my kids is a universal feeling. I'm not the only one that has that kind of feeling, you know, and I'm also probably not the only one to ever make art about it. It's a real good excuse to make a piece of art, you know. I'm using sixes in it, and I always have said a million times around the country that I use odd numbers, you know, that three is an odd number together with another three, then all of a sudden maybe it's not an odd number anymore, you know, and I feel like that I really have to be able to step into other numbers. You know, I have to give the six credence. I have six kids. I mean, six got to be a big time number, you know, in relation to my life. Mm-hmm.
With, you know, numbers are an important part of your work because you deal with, like, kind of multiples, the flower blossoms, you have numbers there, and then they break up and other things as well. But what are some of the other symbols? There's universal symbols that you use that you find to be most important to you now, at present time.
Well, I mean, it's arguable as to what constitutes universal symbols anyway. Mm-hmm. I mean, there's very valid schools of thought that eliminate a whole lot of stuff that I believe in, you know, and vice versa. So you really can take exception to that. I believe that symbols have to be read in relation to something. You have to put them in some kind of context before they then really become symbols. Now, that is almost like in the same breath saying, then that means they're really not universal, you see. And I'll use as an example of that, a circle. A circle has a certain symbolic reference to every country in the world. You know, I mean, you can go draw a circle in the dirt or the ice or anywhere, you know, or the snow, and let a group of people from any culture get around it, contemplate the circle, talk about the circle, and inevitably they come up with union. You know, that's just sort of a human consensus to come up with that. So the circle has to have some kind of symbolic reference to us, you know, that's just inherent in its being. And a spiral is the same way. You know, I mean, how could I discover a spiral? You know, well, I can discover a spiral. It's inherent in my genes. It's inherent in your genes. It's inherent in physical existence, you know. Consequently, then it becomes inherent in spiritual existence. So for me to use that, I'm not using something that I made up, you know, but how can you overdo it? You know, how can the spiral become a cliche? You know, that's like saying noses are cliches. There's a million noses, a billion noses. Probably a million or a billion in one country somewhere. Symbols are really, have to be looked at by the individual. The individual has to look at a particular symbol, try to put themselves into its context, okay, and then deal with it accordingly, knowing all along that this spectator, me included when I'm a spectator, bring with it my trainload of baggage, that I superimpose all of my references and all of my context onto it, which is really not fair to the art. You need to be objective about looking at it. It can't be objective about looking at you. You're giving to it. You have to give something to art to read art. And in there, and all those places, you read symbols.
You're talking in terms of arts being, all your art being self-portraiture in some dimension or another.
Mm-hmm.
Also talking about symbols and context. What are some of the specific symbols that you're using in the context of the work? You know, the eye is one that you use, the house, things like that. What are some of the others that you're kind of using in your vocabulary at present?
I use birds. I use roots. I mean, roots inherently symbolize something. I mean, they just do. You know, they do. I use branches, things that reach, you know, whether it's a branch or an arm or a vine with a bud growing on the top of it, that's still reaching, which is in my state of being in relation to my work, that always insinuates, therefore represents, therefore is symbolic of aspiring to, you know, reaching for, you know, I mean, trying to obtain something. You know, it's really presumptuous on my part to tell you what to aspire to, what to reach for, you know, what you need to obtain. You know, I can't put myself in that position. That's all of a sudden, that's you trying to be the spectator. And you're really not trying to be the spectator. You're really trying to point the spectator in a particular direction. You know, so I think that those things sometimes become real inherent. They have to, because the spectator, a lot of the times, don't consciously read that stuff. You know, they have to be able to pick it up on an intuitive level. You know, you have to be, you're only going to get 2 or 3 seconds from them, I guarantee you. If you get 20 seconds from a spectator, believe me, you have a long time. That's getting them for a long time. So give it the benefit of the doubt. Let's say you get them 20 seconds. In that 20 seconds, you've got to tell them an enormous amount of information, you know, about the existence of some object. It's not really too easy. That's why it takes so long to do it. That's why the wake of an artist becomes broader and broader and broader, you know, I mean, the further through their lives go. You know, I mean, Van Gogh's wake is 300,000 times wider now than it was. He was like a bullet passing through time. You know, 10 years, 25 years, 50 years, 75 years, and on and on and on and on. I mean, Van Gogh's an absolute millionaire. The guy's a millionaire. You know, you say, well, wait a minute, Searles, he's dead. You know, well, I don't think so. You know, I mean, I really don't think so. I think that we still can converse with him. You know, well, how can you do that? Well, you do it through his art. That's how you do it. You look at his art. You conjure images out of it. You know, I mean, you let him guide you in a direction. You know, I mean, you go play with him for a while. You have to do that with symbols. I mean, symbols are really nebulous things. You know, they're not real in the physical world. They're only real in a different world, in a spiritual world, you know, or a eureka world, or whatever you want to call it. I'm just willing to deal with it. I'm willing to let it have credence. You know, I'm willing to give things meaning. You know, I'm not willing to, you know, if a garbage truck's bearing down on me, I'm going to give that meaning. You know, that's, hey, you know, I'm going to believe the truck. Okay, well, why wouldn't you if a leaf fell on you? It's the same thing. I mean, it's a different object, you know, and it's under different circumstances, but nevertheless, it's dealing with some kind of phenomenon that's going on in your life and giving it rhyme and reason as opposed to just saying, oh, it's just an accident. I don't believe in accidents. It's got nothing to do with symbols.
Yeah,
it has a lot to do with Pepsi.
Okay. And Michael Jackson, right? He knows about accidents. In terms of your work, you're working basically with woods. You work with a lot of natural woods that you find near your place or on your acreage down near Houston. Can you talk, maybe describe for people what an average day is when you start a piece or how you begin a piece? Maybe starting in the woods and then going back to the studio and things like that.
I don't know if I have an average day. I mean, I swear to God, I just ricochet through life. Mm-hmm. You know, that's, I mean, you crescendo at least once a day. You know, just, I don't know. I have increased my system constantly. My system has grown and grown and grown and grown, and it takes more and more and more to feed it in terms of time and thinking and money and all the whole business, you know, to the point that it's really hard to say what an average day is in terms of my making art. I work on a lot of different pieces at one time. You know, if I'm working on a piece and I get to a point where I can't work for an hour, I'll work on something else. You know, I mean, you're just kind of developing a studio full of stuff, you know, at one time. And then the studio develops full of stuff, and then you take the stuff out and you ship it off somewhere. You know, I mean, you get it out. You have to get it out. Which, to tell you the truth, was the whole reason for this giant studio that I wanted to build. You know, is that I never had a problem making art. I still don't. I haven't even made any art in that new building. You know, it's not really a matter of whether or not I needed to make it. I needed to put stuff in it. You know, my studio became so full of finished pieces, of things I wanted to work on, things I'm working on, and things that I have finished working on, until it literally, I'm not kidding you, it was like walking through a barn stuffed full of wood. You know, you had to turn sideways and lean and dip and crawl over stuff, yet I managed to keep on making art through it. You know, I mean, it's like you can put a piece of art coming through this way, a big piece, I mean, a 10-foot piece. You can make a 10-foot piece of art in here, and it wouldn't interfere with making a 12-foot art piece that ran around this way. You know, well, if you're willing to divide your space up like that, then you can just keep on being productive. And my whole approach about it really is productivity. You know, I believe it is necessary for you to, quote, make it in the art world, that you have to be prolific in a sense. You can't feed a market, you know, without having created it. You can't create it and then not feed it. If you create it and then can't feed it, it dies, you know, withers. So I think that being productive is really important. It suits me personally to make art a lot, you know, to really work a lot. And I think that it also suits a bigger system to do that.
What about the importance of drawing in your work? I noticed when you started this piece, you started doing some drawing and kind of, you know, mapping things up. Mm-hmm. And I've seen the drawings in your studio, things like that. Most of your pieces originate in drawing, and how important is drawing to you?
Well, they originate in my head. The drawing is just simply a next step. Drawing is to art what poetry is to literature. You know, I mean, drawing is one step removed from the bone. It's as close as you're going to get to the pure thing. You know, the pure thing is that eureka state where you flash and there it is. I mean, you can have a concept come full-blown, you know, in mind. Nowhere else can you do that. The only place that a concept can develop itself into a full-blown picture, spanning thousands of years even, is in your mind. You know, that can't work in physical reality. A piece of paper and a pencil is as close as I can get to that. Words are as close as I can get, saying a word. You know, I saw a bull one time in a pen, a Bramer bull. And my daddy loved Bramer bull, so I looked at the bull, I thought about my daddy, you know, and then I flashed on being the bull. You know, I went and got in him. I was the bull from it. I was standing out there in the middle of this pasture, you know, in mind. I was doing that. And then I elevated. I projected the bull into the sky, into the wind. Then I was the bull in the sky, in the wind. At that point, I let my hands be like engines. You know, you're just making it up. It's imaginary. It's playing. It's mental exercise, you know. But you have to register that, you know. So I did. You know, I said that I wanted to be a humpback beast. That's the bull. I didn't say I want to be a bull. I said I want to be a humpback beast. The reason I said humpback beast as opposed to saying bull is I thought it covered more territory. It made sense to more people under broader circumstances than saying bull. Bull kind of put it in one strata, you see, but beast put it in many stratas. So it's like a way of trying to expand it out. You're constantly trying to expand your concept to its broadest context. See, I'm not about reduction. I don't make art about reducing. I make it about expanding. So here's an image, a real visual image, coming through your little retina, you know, picturing on your brain, and then being turned into a phenomenon, a mental phenomenon, as opposed into just simply a mental picture. I believe all people have the pictures. I don't think I'm unique in that sense. What makes me more unique than some people is that I'm willing to exercise the picture. I'll take the picture through some logical progression. So I want to be a humpback beast with blowing fans. That's the engines. I didn't say engines. Engine's a contemporary word. You see, where blowing fans, again, just cover more psychic territory, I think. Sending winds whipping in the minds of men. That'd be like the second line to it. Okay, so there's a poem starting to develop. It's just a one-line poem. I'm not trying to tell you that, you know, I'm T.S. Eliot. You know, I'm just registering an idea in some kind of what I'd like to term broad context. Okay? It's fun doing that. You know, it's fun registering that. Okay, so I got the image, I got the picture, I got the words, you know, I got the title, that's the handle on the drawing, that then dictates what the drawing is going to be. So I'll go to a piece of paper knowing that I'm going to draw some kind of humpback beast, you know, and I'm going to have his hands up, you know, and I'm going to have this stuff, this whirling mass of stuff coming around his hands. It's all fabricated, you see, it's all just made up, you know. I'm willing to give it significance. I'm willing to say, this mental phenomenon that just transpired in my mind has significance to me. I'm not willing to dismiss it as being nothing. You see, that's otherworldly, so to speak, but I give otherworldly phenomenon credence, saying it is as real as is the tangible world that we live in. I mix them up all the time. You know, it makes life interesting. Just makes it more interesting to do that. So now I've got the thought, I've got the words, step one, step two, I've got the picture, I've got the drawing, step three, now comes the last one, taking it into that form, dimension, letting it exist out of being just a dot or a wavy line or a straight line or a series of marks on a piece of paper. That's all symbolic of something. So you asked me about symbols. The beast obviously is symbolic. You know, I mean, you can mention the word beast, and I guarantee you there's a little bump on the back of everybody's back because they've got a beast somewhere. You know, I mean, they've dealt with the beast somewhere, real or otherwise. You know, you don't get through life without it. Just part of existence. So the beast is symbolic. The fans are symbolic. The winds are symbolic. You know, it's all symbolic of something. Now, as to whether or not the spectator looks at that drawing and perceives everything I said just now, I don't really expect them to, you know? I mean, I'm not so naive as to think that they're all going to be able to look at what I do and totally read my images. They're not, because in truth, they're not geared toward reading images. You know, it's like you could see a bear track, and if you didn't know it was a bear track, and you just walked on by, there could be a major symbol, you know what I mean, or a thing representing something there that could, you know, be of a big deal in your life, but if you didn't know it, if you couldn't read it. And we're not really geared to read. We don't really look at art. I'm telling you, we don't really look at art.
What would you suggest as perhaps a remedy to that kind of visual illiteracy? Is there a remedy?
Well, my remedy is trying to appeal to a broader group of people on purpose, consciously, on purpose. I mean, I do that. And here's why I do it. Here's how I do it. I think that when I was imprinting on the art world, abstract was, in a sense, reigning supreme. Reductive direction was reigning supreme. It looked to me like art was heading in a point where I projected forward and saw it as reducing itself to zero and saw I saw no avenue for me there. It looked like it was a dead-end street. So in the process of making my art more collective, okay, more additive, more multi-strated, Okay, I think with each strata, you have the chance of hitting a strata of people. You match stratas with stratas of people. In other words, one person can look at your art and only see one facet of it, and then deal with it under those circumstances. If you have 10 facets, then you have a chance of reaching, compounding itself, a whole bigger group of people, just simply because it's multifaceted. You see what I'm saying? I mean, in a sense, I look at that as like trying to appeal to a certain point in somebody. You know, I mean, sentimentality is totally insipid if you deal with it only as sentimentality. I mean, sentimentality for the sake of sentimentality, just because it exists, and if you go bathe in it, I mean, you turn into syrup. You know, I mean, it can get gooey quick. You know, so it's treacherous territory. I guarantee you, it is much easier to make a negative piece of art. It's much easier to do than it is to make a positive piece of art, one that actually deals with something as sentimental as sentimentality, and make it come off being significant as opposed to just being some sort of an insipid statement. What does that have to do with anything?
Well, I think basically, I think it comes down to your structuring, you know, a wider appeal in terms of content. That seems to be the answer to the visual literacy thing. Talk about, if you would, some of the influences, early influences, maybe in childhood, of making things. Mm-hmm. And putting
I can tell you some early influences. I lived in the country. I was born in a real small town, then immediately moved to the country. So all of my, from 2 years old to first grade memories, those first conscious memories, I lived in the country. My daddy went off to work. My little sister was a little teeny baby, had to stay in the house. My mother stayed in the house with her, or close to the house with her. I had my older brother to lead me places, okay, away from the house, okay, when I was like 3 years old and 4 years old. When I was 4 years old, he went to first grade. He got on a school bus. He walked a mile down the road, got on a school bus, and drove off. So here I was, left. See, miles and miles from anybody to play by myself. You know, I played with my daddy's dogs. My daddy hunted. He was a coon hunter. I loved to coon hunt, you know. Where's the person that talked about coon hunting last night? My daddy hunts. I mean, that's what he does. I mean, that was like his first love in life, really, was hunting. Well, he had always had like at least 5 to 10 puppies, hound puppies, around. You know, I played with those big old floppy puppies. We would go run rabbits, you know, which my daddy hated, he'd get me for. He'd let me tie bacon or something on a coon skin on a string and then drag it all around and then go chase them with it, you know. So I got to have what I would call psychological freedom, you know, away from my center real early. And I think that's major. And I got rewarded for creative activity, and I'll tell you how. My brother and I chopped a tree down. It's just like George Washington's story, okay? My brother and I chopped a tree down. The tree was about probably 12 inches in diameter, and a oak tree, so it's like a pole, you know, like it grew in the woods. We chopped the thing down with hatchets, okay? We hacked and hacked and hacked and hacked and hacked and hacked until tree fell over. It took us a day. I mean, there's two little kids out there hacking. I mean, with incredible determination, but hacking and hacking and hacking. We cut the tree down. Well, a lot of parents would have come home and said, "Oh my God, boys, you could have been killed doing that. Don't chop a tree down without unless I'm there, or never chop another tree down." And you know, even some daddies would have whipped off their belt and kawapa, 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 you know. And but what I'm saying is there. Negative response, some kind of negative response to an action that a child does that they are big deal about. Okay, he took the tree and used it as a corner post for a turkey pen. So in other words, we got psychologically rewarded for our actions there. You know, another case I think I mentioned the other night or some time or another. We took all of my mother's little red rubber rings that she put on her ball jars you know, and those seal type things. We took all those things, boxes of them that she was fixing to use in canning and jarring food. We took them and wove them all together, you know, and made this thing that hung, you know, and then looped it around a tree so that it was a. It's art. That's all you can say for it. That was art. That was exercising some kind of internal creativity, you know. God, we could put all these things together and make a, you know, God knows what you could make. Well, you know, we could have gotten real trouble for that, is the truth of the matter, you know. I mean, some parents would have come home, you know, or walked around and said, oh, my God, boys, what are y'all doing? Y'all have ruined all of our blah, 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 you know what I mean? Co-opa, 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 co-opa. You get your ass beat again. You know, it happens all the time. You know, well, it didn't happen in, you know, in our case. They said, boys, y'all shouldn't use those. Those, we need those for, you know. Here's why we need them. Here's what you guys did with them, you know. And boy, don't it look great, you know. I mean, and ain't it interesting, you know. And okay, well, let's take them all back apart and wash them all up and put them back into the mainstream of where they're belonging in the first place. We just took something out of context of one thing, you know, put it in a childlike context, and in a sense got some kind of psychological reward and satisfaction for having done it. Now that's major. I'm looking back on all that retrospectively and telling you something that I have thought about as an adult. You see, I think that kids have the ability to do that. Humans, when they get grown, lose the ability to do that because they simply don't exercise the ability to do that. If they exercise that ability, then that ability grows and gets stronger and more elastic and tougher, and you know, I mean, you get to, you know, it's just it's part of compounding phenomenon. It just works that way, you know. But we don't really do it. We really sort of fall victim in a sense to regimentation, visual regimentation.
So we lose our sense of play, is that
I guess that's what I'm saying.
Basically, kind of grow, we lose our imaginations, we get sacrificed other things.
Mm-hmm. The people that usually end up actually going ahead and exercising it are folk artists are people that do that, you know. Naive artists are people that do that. You know, they continue on to doing it, not really questioning it. They don't do it in a conscious sense, they just simply kind of do it in an intuitive sense. You know, I can't be a naive artist, but I've got a consciousness that I project out there and I perceive information and look for bigger pictures, you know. So being a naive artist insinuates that you work down at the core and you only stay at the core, you know. Well, you have to be at the core. All artists have to be at the core. They also have to project out.
Well, curious, talking about in art terms, I think that there's always art influences art, artists, people, kind of your, from the Hall of Fame, I guess, who were the people that you would say that were direct influence on you?
Orozco was a real major direct influence on me because I saw his art real early. When I first became an art major in college, by the end of the first year during that summer, you know, like all good art students in Texas, I went to Mexico, you know. I went to what's now the dope capital of the world, Guadalajara. You know, at that time, that element didn't exist for students that went there. You know, I mean, I went and actually looked at Orozco murals, giant ones, big ones, burning people. You know, I'm talking about human phenomenon personified, you know, in this unbelievable, towering, heroic manner. You know, that's major. That's a major imprint for me, you know. I like that. My influences, to tell you the truth, all grew through that kind of romantic connection. None of my influences really came from the left bank, the jug of wine, the piece of cheese, the hair shirt, you know, the cedar bar, you know, abstract. That I really miss that. I was in another place, in another time, in another space, having other influences. And then older, became conscious of that other system, knowing full well that I never fit into the other system. You know, I mean, I couldn't make myself fit in if I, you know, pushed and molded and pried and stuffed. I mean, you just simply can't daub me into the other system. I mean, there's a whole It's a whole another sensibility that grew up. You can call it a hybrid, you know, you can call it anything you want to call it. I came to surrealism through the back door. You know, I got surrealism through Mexico. I didn't get surrealism through New York, you know what I mean? So it's a little different sensibility at work. I was willing to exercise real romantic feelings, you know, when that really wasn't the thing to do necessarily. You know, I mean, during the 70s, sculpture was a big block setting on the horizon. You know, I'm not knocking Tony Smith. I don't have to go kill Tony Smith. I mean, I understand from the context that he grew, you know. I mean, it's not necessary for me to stab him to make me look good. You know, I respect him as a sculptor, you know, as an artist, as a thinker, as a person. You know, I give his art serious credence, you know, very important. But that's not where I'm going. It's not where I came from. It's not the context that I grew out of, you know. So I don't know how I could fit into it in that sense. And I think it's okay, and recently even being sort of said okay, you know, that we live in a pluralistic society and that's all right. You know, we can deal with that. Although the Whitney Biennial wasn't really necessarily a
pluralistic
any indication of that. I mean, it really pretty well stuck to the home front. You know, it pulled from the home front to really, and in a weird kind of way ends up making it a more regional show than the regional show, you know, because it really becomes of a region.
Mm-hmm. If you're talking about like resources and, you know, energy sources to get your imagery from, you're talking to young artists, and you have been talking to some of our students here this week. What kind of advice would you give them? What would you tell them to something they might want to search out, perhaps themselves or something? What would that be?
Well, you know, God knows what advice you give anybody about anything. You know, I mean, my real advice to anybody under any circumstances is to really believe in yourself. I mean, the truth of it is, you know you better than anybody else knows you. You know, you can listen to you better than anybody else can listen to you. It's just that people don't really take their own advice. You know, they get stuck in a rut. They give themselves great advice. You know, boy, I ought to. And then they name off all the great things they ought to do, you see. I actually name off all the great things I ought to do and then do my best to exercise them. You see, where most people really can name all the great things off, they just don't exercise them. They'll go ahead and stay in their rut, you see. And I think it's the reason that the casualty rate in art schools is so high, you know, and it is really high. I mean, the amount of people that get art degrees and then get out and function and live and prosper in relation to what they've learned in college the percentages are pretty low. It's actually what I'd call tragic, which is the reason I think that art schools really have to be revamped. I think we've got to have a higher success rate. You know, I mean, I would really like to see that. And I think that part of the reason is that we don't really teach them how to exercise phenomenon, you know, which is really what we should be doing. Well, you have to be an egotistical person to exercise phenomenon. You really have to believe in yourself to exercise phenomenon. And I don't think that young students have enough confidence in themselves. In truth, I believe that already, right now, today, full blown, there is a process in them that would allow them to make high art. You know, they don't have to learn how to weld, they don't have to learn how to cast bronze, they don't have to learn how to chop on a piece of wood, they don't have to learn how to chip stone, they don't have to learn how to do any of that stuff to make a piece of art. You know, it really has to do with concept in relation to exercising that concept. What's the most direct way to exercise the concept? You know, and a lot of times they'll have a great concept, then they will impose on that great concept some big old giant chunk of something or other that they can't really physically deal with anyway. So they struggle along there through process. They're back, they bog down in process. I mean, all those tools are great, but you know, you've got to have some kind of thing that you attach to it. You know, that's concept. All those magic tools out there do, those allow you to physically exercise stuff. But you know, what happens when you graduate from here? What happens when you leave here and all of a sudden you're back in the real world, you know, sitting at 1522 Lexington Avenue, you know, in some town somewhere in the United States of America, and you don't have the big grinder and you don't have the big welding machine and you don't have the forks and the tongs and the lifts and the the big doors and the, you know, the peripheral support system that's around you, you know, and then you get out and you go, you know, until you just gradually start building back up. I would like to see that changed to some degree. I'd like to see people that gets out of school and be able then to make a direct step, you know, right into a professional world, you know, as opposed to bumping and skidding and just sort of fading out somewhere. What was the question?
Advice to young art students.
Believe in themselves. I'm totally serious about that. I mean, that may be cliche-ish as hell, I don't know, you know, but in truth, the power of singular belief allows you to do anything. You can do anything operating under the power of singular belief. Totally believing in yourself means that you have to operate in that sphere. That's what makes Grandma Moses so absolutely great. She got up one morning and said, "Oh my God, I believe I can do it." You know, well, then there's no question about it. I mean, absolutely no question about it. She can do it. You see, I mean, it's when you question and question and question and question yourself and you question until you humble yourself before all of these tools and all of this stuff to the point that you can't exercise things, you know, and it's really important to be able to do it, and even if it's a simple way. It doesn't have to be, you know, heavy and bulky and all that other stuff. Yeah. Why don't more girls make it? That's amazing to me, you know, that the amount of, in freshman classes, there's always like twice as many girls as there are boys. By the time they get to be seniors, you know, there's just a few more. It evens up some point, but there's still more girls than there are boys. And then in graduate school, it changes a little bit. It starts to reverse itself until it gets at the top, and then it's all boys. You know, not all boys, but a whole bunch of them are. You know, and I don't understand why the girls don't make a better showing at the top when they start off in such strong numbers at the bottom. And it all has to do with the ability to exercise stuff and how they're taught to do it and how they have confidence in themselves. Just to, you know, I mean, you think about it a minute. A girl can push a button just as easy as a boy can. You know, you don't have to be a big old man, you know, to push a button to raise 10 tons. Anybody can raise 10 tons. It doesn't make any difference who they are. You know, it don't have to be Herculean to do that. And I think that schools sometimes get more oriented in process, you see, and they kind of get bogged down a little in process more than they do in exercising ideas. I think it would be real healthy for a school to offer a class in just an imaginary art. This is play-like art. Okay, so all you do is you go to class, you can just report to class once a week with your pretend piece. You know, and you get to sit there and discuss the merits of this imaginary thing that don't even exist. But what it does is it allows you to exercise something to that next level, and it would make it get more easier and more complicated in other places. I would like to see young students deal more in mind than they do in tangible, real.
Okay, question in terms of relating, well, we're talking about students and curriculum to some degree here, the idea of relating possibly some of the things you've seen in the exhibition, and maybe want to talk a little about having juried that and, you know, what was involved.
Well, what was involved was looking at a whole group of slides. I mean, you're looking at pictures. It's obviously a major step removed from the reality of the thing, so it looks on a slide one way, you perceive it one way, and then in reality it may not necessarily be really that way. So seeing, walking into the show and seeing it up, and then remembering having seen the slide and kind of putting my mental picture with the reality of the thing, there were some fuzzy areas. Excuse me, there were some fuzzy areas there, you know, where you have to kind of bring it back into focus. I really enjoyed doing it. I really enjoyed doing things like that. I mean, I like looking at art. Looking at art is fun to me. You know, I mean, it brings me something. You know, and the fact that I don't like something does not mean that I don't respect from where it came. You know, I mean, I think that if you took all of the artists and the art-related types in the whole world, okay, and bunched them all up into one group, I'm talking about the art world at all of its levels, if you bunched them all up into one group, It's such a tiny percentage of humanity. It's such a tiny, tiny, tiny percentage of humanity that to me there's really no room in there to bump somebody off. You know, you don't really have to be a gunslinger, you know, in it. So, you know, I can't like everything. That's part of what creates the dialogue that allows us to exist anyway. You know, that's the churning process of what we do, you know, and there's no way I'm gonna like everything. It just simply doesn't work that way. And sometimes I like or don't like something for a particular reason, you know. For instance, I'll give you an example. Okay, there's a piece of art in here by, I think, somebody named Princess Cook. I looked at the label, and that's what it says. I loved her piece of art. I liked the idea of this sort of this ghost person sitting, contemplating with themselves on the wall, you know, looking into this daydream kind of phenomenon. I really like that as a concept, and I like the way that came into being. I didn't like the colors. I didn't like the baby blue. I didn't like the pastel yellow. You see, I didn't really like the pink in that sense. I thought that what that did is it was like saying, oh, I have to go back into my childhood to daydream. You see, I thought that backed her up a bit, you know, where I could look at the figure and tell that this is a grown person. You know, or it looked to me like it's a grown person. I certainly was going to deal with it as a grown person sitting there, you know, in every respect, you know, except for these little girl colors in this little girl room's existence, you know. I would have changed that element about that piece of art. Well, that's not my piece of art to change. You know, it's not even necessarily my responsibility to tell that person that. You know, artists are real sensitive. They get their feelings hurt. You go and say, hey, Princess, I don't like your colors, you know. Oh my God, you know, I mean, that's real treacherous territory in it, you know. But I feel like artists ought to tell each other that. You know, you owe it to somebody to tell them that is the truth of the matter. You know, that's part of learning, you know. I mean, if somebody walks up to me, I can tell you somebody did walk up to me. Alan Stone, a dealer in New York that I totally respect and like, okay, and look back, you know, in the last 15 years of my having known of his existence, that guy's done a tremendous amount in the art world. He carries a lot of psychological weight. He came into my studio and was standing there looking at a major piece of mine, a big, giant, major piece, telling me that he thought I had trimmed it too much. You know, he said, well, you know, when I trim my hedges, you know, I try to shape it, and he's equating his trimming a hedge with my making this piece of sculpture, which was equatable. You could make that connection. He thought I trimmed it back too much. I'd stubbed it up too much. You know, well, what do I do? Do I try and say, you know, I mean, or do I listen to what he said and look at it as a valid opinion? You know, and then look at it and go back and look at my art and say, well, did I or didn't I? You know, can I do this or, you know, what's... I have to have some kind of response to it. I can have an intellectual response, you know, and deal with it accordingly, or I could have only, you know, an emotional response and punch the guy out if I was offended by it. You know, it hurt my feelings a little bit, you know, because I'm a human being. You know, somebody standing there telling you why they don't like something about your art. You know, I mean, I went twitch, you know, twang. You know, I mean, I felt the nick of the conversation. You know, but hey, that's interesting. You know, that's interesting when people come up and push on you a little bit like that. You know, I mean, I think that's what Wanda was doing last night. You know, she came over and pushed on me a little bit. You know, well, I respected that. I mean, I ended up after the conversation was over, feeling very good about the conversation and about having had the conversation. I think that's really healthy. What's that got to do with the question? I forgot.
I forgot what the question was. We're talking about the show, and you're talking about making selections.
Oh, why? I would say what selections. I did about Princess Cook's art.
Well, I think it comes down to you're talking in terms.
See, what I'm saying is I didn't. There was part of it I didn't like, and part of it I did like. You know, but I'm not willing to axe that piece of art because there's something in it I don't like.
But also, I think you're saying that as your role as juror, that you owe at least, you know, a straight shot from yourself, that you owe the artist a truthful assessment or evaluation of what they're doing.
That's part of what makes me me, is I'm always willing to tell you, you know, and take my shots in doing it. I think that we owe that to each other. I mean, artist to artist, you know, peer to peer. You know, I mean, we got to have some kind of psychological camaraderie in the deal, you know, and if you can't really do that with one another without getting mad, you know, that's terrible. Basically, I liked the show. You know, I mean, I guess I did. There was a whole bunch of pieces that didn't get in, and evidently I didn't like those as much as the ones that did get in. You know, so, I mean, everything is in here for a reason, and God knows it doesn't all look alike. It certainly doesn't all represent the same direction, you know, and a couple of them, you know, to tell you the truth, I think they're really ugly. You know, I mean, aesthetically, I'm not real nuts about the pieces. You know, I just simply like to comment. You know, so I put them in because of the comment, not because of the aesthetic nature of whether or not they were designed well or made well. You know, I mean, I put them in because I thought they had some kind of comment to make, you know, ugly or otherwise. I mean, that guy in there holding that rocket ship in his hand, you know. I have to tell you, I'm not real nuts about that piece of art, you know. I mean, I don't really like the tall, skinny figure like that. I mean, you know, I in one sense, I don't take that piece of art seriously. You know, in another sense, I take it totally seriously. You know, here's a guy trying to make a comment about from where we came and where we're going. I mean, that's a real major endeavor to do. You know, I mean, a guy standing there naked for all practical purposes, you know, with a rocket in his hand. You know, I mean, that's from the hut. That's from the mud hut. That's from the bush almost. I mean, that's from back from the very primal part of our beginnings, you know, into a space age. I mean, this guy attempted something real major. You know, I mean, he actually attempted to make a major statement. I wasn't real nuts, to tell you the truth, about the way he made the statement. I'm not fond of his figures. You know, the woman in the saddle is the same way. I personally think that's ridiculous. You know, it's really ugly. You know, I mean, I thought it, I just thought the figure looked ugly, just to tell you the truth. Just about as ugly as anything I've ever seen, you know? But I'm real conscious, you know, of the fact that the matriarchal system has been saddled. It has. I mean, that's no question. It has, you know? The patriarchal system has dominated. The rocket really has dominated. There's no question that it's dominated. You know, I mean, that's just a sort of a psychological fact in our time that it has. So the fact that he put the woman in the saddle, that's major. You know, I mean, that's major. That guy took two incredible ideas, you know, and exercised them in a real old-fashioned sort of traditional way that you know, is an acceptable way of working, you know. I would eliminate the process if I were that guy. I wouldn't work in that way. I'd blow that off. And God, how can you stand up and tell somebody to blow off their process? I mean, that's ridiculous. You can't. You know, I mean, I'm just saying I wouldn't use that process, but I would use those ideas. I loved his ideas. So I put them in the show for that reason. You know, somehow or another, it's important for the audience, the spectator, to think about those two things. I think those two things are worthy of thinking about. You know, I wish I liked the other part of his art, you know, but I really don't. And I guess, you know, I mean, I'm just trying to answer a question real honestly, you know, as to why I would put something in and why I wouldn't. Or how I could not like something in one sense and still put it in the show. You know, I mean, I don't have to like everything about it. I mean, that's put such restrictive limitations on what you can and cannot do, you'd end up only putting two or three things in the show. You just put the prize winners in, that's all. It's just show them.
Speaking of prize winners, have you had a chance to make your final selection, John?
I've made two.
Made two.
Let me tell you.
No, let's save it till Friday night. We'll all be surprised at the same time.
He tells what he likes. Oh my God, why did he?
Right.
Get a rope. That's the ugliest thing I've ever seen.
Thank you, James. Appreciate it. Very much.
Asking which one he likes.
Huh?
might talk about which ones you really do like, or...
Want to talk about that?
Well, that's what I said.
Want to do the selections?
Well, not the selections, but I mean, do you have any that you want to kind of point out that...
Well, then I'd tell you my selection.
I guess you might.
You don't have to tell us the numerical order.
Hide the two selections.
Well, I think it's okay to tell. I think it's going to be another big old giant crowd around here. They won't know the information anyway. They'll all act surprised.
We'll make your face sign a blood oath there.
Sure. Here you guys are not going to... Hey, I'll tell you something. The art world lies. They'll tell anything. I mean, that's,
I won't tell nobody.
Sure. Immediately start saying, have you heard? That's what I was talking about.
Where'd you get that white car?
Where did you get that white car? Did you buy that with grant money?
Yeah. How did you get
it? I bought that car with a National Endowment grant. I will guarantee you're going to be hearing
We've
that.
We've got it on tape now. You should talk about the pieces that you've selected so far.
Okay, well, my second choice is the Princess Cook piece.
Right.
I mean, I actually like that piece, and I like enough about it, you know, even though I didn't like the colors. And all I'm doing when I say that is I look at it and see a way that I think that piece could have improved itself tremendously. You know, that person had a lot of potential in relation to that concept and that idea. And if I were her, I would do it again and again and again and again. And I wouldn't call that repeating myself. I'd just call that honing something down. You know, it's honing down an idea to where it's speaking as clearly as you want to speak. That's all. So I liked it a lot. So I gave it second. There's one I like better. And it's the black box in there. I like the fact that the guy controlled the whole environment of a piece. He actually set up a total context for you to deal with it under. He is appealing to a whole lot of sensory perception on your part. You know, he is asking you to deal with something in a complete way. You know, that's really major. You know, it's major for us as sculptors because traditionally we've made objects. We have asked a spectator to look at an object. This guy's saying, look at the object in relation to this phenomenon. He's controlling the phenomenon around the piece as much as he is the piece, and it creates an incredible aura around it. You know, I mean, it's a person with one foot in a boat. You know, I mean, well, I like that. I mean, that's symbolic of something. You know, that's symbolic of being afloat. You know, it's symbolic of having a partial control. The other foot wasn't in the boat. You know, so that means that you're, you know, it's like you're not in total control. It was multi-reaching. You know, it was a multitude of things around it that was all reaching for something, which again, I would equate to aspiring to something. You know, I mean, the same as I would in my own work, the same as I would in anybody's work, you know, that had something, had a hand reaching up. I mean, you know, a hand reaching up is symbolic of something, whether I use it, he uses it, or some Hindu uses it. You know, I mean, it carries with it a certain symbolic gesturing. You know, so I like that part of it. And I particularly like the noises that he had with it, which I thought seemed really straightforward and honest in relation to the piece. The noise worked with the piece. It was like the noises that went along with it, even though I believe them to be real. They were recorded from real, so it was like something that exists out there that he can control and plant into another place. You see, he didn't have to, in a sense, carve the noises or, you know, create the noises himself. You know, I think it was okay to go get the noises. You know, he was responsible for using them, so I give him full credit for him being in there. I think that the stuff on the floor, the needles, the leaves, you know, helped create an overall ambience to the place that became then yet again even more important for the boat. You know, it was like the boat was afloat on this stuff, you see, and in this case, this stuff being a natural substance, leaves and pine needles and things like that, which really does take on a floating surface. You know, if you go through the woods and if you see a pine forest under that circumstances, that's sort of again, taking something from an existing phenomenon and using it, I thought, in a real positive way. So I pretty much liked everything about the piece. You know, I mean, it really satisfied me on more levels than any of the other ones. Another piece in here that I like, and I may give it third prize, I don't know that I will, I hadn't decided yet as to whether or not I will, is the little figure dancing. You know, it's not dancing, it's being pushed and pulled, mechanically pushed and pulled. I mean, here's some mechanisms that is controlling the existence of this little bare-bones person down here, which becomes not a person or a specific person, but because it's bones, I think it represents many persons. That's humanity down there. You know, I'm willing to let it grow to that extent, you see. And here's something that's a totally ugly structure. You know, these little silver rods, which I hate. I hate little silver rods, you know, and little wires and, you know, little mechanical looking devices in art, which is basically is not pleasing for me to look at. You know, it has no aesthetic value whatsoever as far as I'm concerned, but actually deals with a real phenomenon that exists in our age. You know, mechanisms and devices and systems, electronic systems, that in a sense really do control our movements and control our life. You know, and there's that little figure just being pushed and then pulled and then pushed and he flops and he pulls and, you know, I thought that was pretty heavy duty. You know, for me, I stood there and looked at that thing and went, you know, I saw myself as being that little figure. I put myself in its position, you know, thinking then in terms of all these mechanisms as being giant, you know, bigger than just I was down there. You know, I mean, that's what you have to do to look at art. You have to put yourself in its position. So if I'm going to put myself into that piece of art, that little figure's who I'm going to put myself into, you know. And I had you know, and actually had some kind of psychological response to the piece, you know, that was stronger than, I'll say, some of the other pieces, you know. I don't mean there's not other pieces in the show that I liked, that I didn't like. I mean, there's a lot of other stuff in the show that I liked, you know, but just overall, I liked those pieces, you know, for that reason. And probably I give that thing third prize. I mean, I don't. There's some other pieces that I like too.
If you use the show as a barometer of what's happening in contemporary sculpture in the United States, would you think it's a healthy indication?
I don't look at it as a barometer as to what's going on in the United States. I look at it as a barometer as to what's going on in a certain strata of the United States, you know, or in a certain segment of the United States. In a bigger picture, I know a lot of people, I think, are great sculptors that didn't enter the show. You know, so on a world picture, I mean, if you want to put it in the big picture like that, I don't think that it's applicable in the big picture. I think it's important to show art. It is important to have your art seen. It is important to have, you know, to, you know, I'll use the word come together, okay? It is important, you know, to somehow mix it up. It's almost like if you were a band, you know, you play this place on this night. You know, you can't look at that as being, you know, the big play, you know? I mean, you look at it as one night of playing in relation to a whole bunch of nights of playing that collectively all add up to a bigger picture, you know? So I look at this exhibition as being a component, you know, in the bigger picture. You know, I mean, I wouldn't be here if I didn't think it's important. I mean, I have to tell you, I don't participate in stuff that I don't feel like is important. I mean, I got too much to do. I'm too busy. I got things that I want to do that, you know, that don't have anything to do with those unimportant things, you know what I mean? So what I'm telling you is I give the show full credence. I think that the show has an importance. I think it does play a role, you know, but I'm trying to be honest with you again. You asked me a question of it in relation to the bigger picture.
Not necessarily, but as a barometer just of what's happening, what's being produced. Mm-hmm. And not, you know, putting up there with, you know, DeSouvreau and Tony Smith and, you know, those guys, mm-hmm. or Sarah, whatever. But the idea of thinking of, like, what's being produced in the variety of things that's in the show. Mm-hmm. There's a lot of different idioms, a lot of different kinds of things that people are working in. Mm-hmm. If you thought it was a healthy indication of good activity, or if you feel that things are to become minimalized or?
Yeah, I think it's a, I think it's a healthy sign, you know, and it's healthy for me for this reason. I now know the names of some other artists that I didn't know before, you know. I mean, my picture has expanded, you know. I guarantee you, it just works this way. I guarantee you, I'll run into some of these people. You know, inevitably I will. I mean, I mentioned that person, Princess Cook's name. I've never met that person. I don't know that person. I'll bet you a $5 bill that within 2 months I run into her somewhere. You know, I mean, to me it just kind of works that way. It's, you know, it's like thickening the soup or something.
You were talking last night about the kind of the small geography of the art world, and sooner or later you do meet up with just about everyone at some point in time, or know someone that does.
You see, I love to eliminate words. I already told you I want to eliminate the word unreal, I want to eliminate the word abstract. I mean, I could go through and name three or four more that I'd like to eliminate, and another one I'd like to eliminate is regional. You know, there was a great show just done in Houston called Fresh Paint, you know, the Houston School. Well, I don't mind it being called the Houston School. I actually think there is a Houston School. I mean, I'll go along with the core of the premise of its existence, but in the catalog, I would have eliminated all the words, all the words that said regional. Every time it said regional, I just draw a line through it, where it would say something like, da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da, the important regional school, da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da, I would have said, da-da-da-da-da-da-da, the important school, da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da, you see? Where I would have, it would have then been put in the context of an important train of thought as opposed to an important regional train of thought. You see, I think that because we live on a sphere and we're totally conscious of the fact that we live on a sphere, that at any point on the sphere can be the center. I mean, how can you find the center of a ball? You see, I mean, anywhere can be the center unless we want the North and South Pole to be the centers, because that's where the axes are, but it's too cold there. We're not, that's not what's going to be. So it really becomes like a center of activity. Well, activity has been so diffused now, you know, I mean, it has been so spread out now that it's possible to participate, you know, hey, from anywhere. I mean, you really and truly, you can. I mean, there really are telephones, airplanes, telecommunications. I mean, there's all kinds of ways. Trucking. You can have your art from here to there to yonder. 2 or 3 days, you can have it anywhere in America. You know, and just, we live in that day and age, you know, I just take those things for granted that we can do that. So the term regional, I think, is kind of becoming obsolete to me. I don't even like the word now, you know, it doesn't make sense to me. I mean, I can tell you for a fact that if you want to take the word regional and use it in its purest sense, okay, then by every stretch of the imagination, the Whitney Biennial is a regional exhibition. You see? I mean, so there's a regional show. Now, you think about it a minute. No, I don't think about it a minute. Forget it.
Good. Thank you, James.
Okay. That's great.
Excellent.